Just a little while ago, I had a chance to sit down and speak with the Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, about some of the major issues facing Mr. Trump and others here in Argentina. And I started by asking the Secretary of State about his recollections of President George Herbert Walker Bush. Mr. Secretary, thanks so much for joining us.
Wolf, it's great to be with you.
Let's talk about the late President George H.W. Bush. How do you see his legacy?
It's a remarkable American legacy. They don't make them like that very often. I had a chance to get to know him when I was a member of Congress first, and then I held a job that he held at one point. And I remember talking to him just after I was nominated to be the CIA director, and he said, "You'll be great. You'll be awesome." In fact, it was the second best job I ever had. And he loved that group of people, that talented espionage agency, so much. America is worse off today, and I want to extend mine and Susan's heartfelt sympathy to the entire Bush family.
What lessons can politicians today learn from the life he led?
It was a true life of service. He was also committed to his faith, and he was willing to work really hard. Maybe those would be the three things. If you work at it, if you keep your faith, and you have this commitment to serve, good things can happen, not only to him. He had a remarkable life, but you'll do good work for your fellow man as well. President Bush certainly did that.
He was an amazing man, and I was blessed
amazing.
Myself to have interviewed him on several occasions. I know if he were here, he'd want us to get to substantive issues. So in his memory, let's talk about some of the major national security issues facing the U.S. right now. Saudi Arabia. Do you believe the Saudi explanation that the Crown Prince, Mohammed bin Salman, did not know about the murder of Jamal Khashoggi?
Wolf, I've spoken about this a lot. I continue to work on this issue. President Trump and this administration sanctioned 17 people that we came to learn were connected to the murder, the heinous murder of Jamal Khashoggi. All across the United States government, we continue to investigate, to try and learn, to make determinations about what happened, and we'll continue to hold those responsible accountable. We've been very, very, very clear about that since literally the very beginning. We also, Wolf, and this is important, are doing everything we can to make sure that we get it right for America, that we keep the strategic relationship with the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and protect the American people. Those two things can both be done, and we've done it very effectively today.
Because you have said that, and you're a former CIA director, so you understand how U.S. intelligence analysis works. You said there's no direct reporting connecting the Crown Prince to order the murder of Jamal Khashoggi. Can you confidently tell his four children that he was not involved in that order?
Well, obviously, sitting in an unclassified setting, here's what I can say. I have read every piece of intelligence that is in the possession of the United States government. And when it is done, when you complete that analysis, there's no direct evidence linking him to the murder of Jamal Khashoggi. That is a accurate statement, is an important statement, and it is the statement that we are making publicly today.
Did the CIA conclude with high confidence that he was involved?
I can't comment on intelligence matters, CIA conclusions. I didn't do it when I was the director. I'm not going to do it now.
Because you've seen all the reports in the media about that.
I've seen lots of reports in the media, Wolf. They often are untrue.
So the bottom line is that the U.S. is going to continue to maintain the same relationship, strategic cooperation with Saudi Arabia right now, irrespective of what may have happened.
Today, we're working with the Saudis in Afghanistan. We're working with the Saudis to push back against the Ayatollah Khomeini, who killed hundreds of Americans, Wolf. And they are an enormous support to us. They are a relationship that has mattered for 70 years across Republican and Democrat administrations alike. And it remains an important relationship, and we're aiming to keep that relationship with the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia.
Because you're losing support in Congress, even including among Republicans right now, to continue U.S. support for the Saudi operation in Yemen. Even Lindsey Graham voted against your position. I think there were 14 Republican senators who voted against you the other day in the Senate.
Secretary Mattis and I and the President have made very clear we're working to end the hostilities in Yemen. The humanitarian crisis there is of epic proportions. Millions of people at or near starvation. This administration has put almost $1 billion into stopping that humanitarian crisis. The Saudis have put even more money in of theirs. The Iranians, Wolf, have put $0 in to stopping that humanitarian crisis. And we are determined to fix the problem of the humanitarian crisis while ensuring that we don't end up with a Hezbollah organization on the southern edge of Saudi Arabia.
So U.S. military support for the Saudis in Yemen will continue.
The program that we're involved in today, we intend to continue.
Let's talk about Russia, another critical issue. Why did the president decide to cancel what was supposed to be a two-hour face-to-face meeting with the Russian leader?
I can actually answer that. I was there. He canceled it because the Russians behaved in a way that is deeply inconsistent with international law and is outrageous. To have held the Ukrainians that they took in the Strait needs to be changed. The president wanted to send a clear, unambiguous message that we find that type of behavior unacceptable, and so he canceled the meeting.
The Russians have done other awful things, and the president went ahead in Helsinki and had that long meeting.
This happened hours, days before the series of events unfolded. Hours and days before, and the president made the decision that the right thing to do was tell the Russians, return the sailors, return the Ukrainian equipment. It's theirs. The people need to be returned to their families. And he wanted to send an unambiguous message that the Russians needed to change that act.
It had nothing to do with the announcement that came just an hour earlier before he boarded Air Force One to fly here to Argentina, that Michael Cohen was cooperating with Mueller and had all these new information, details about a supposed Trump Tower project in Moscow.
Ludicrous. Washington parlor game.
Well, explain, because
I was involved in the decision, Wolf. Yeah. I can explain it
really
easily.
You were aboard Air Force One.
I was aboard Air Force One.
And nobody discussed Michael Cohen.
Wolf, this is the thing that the American people need to understand about Washington, D.C. It makes stuff up that is wholly unfounded. I was involved in the decision-making process. We evaluated it carefully. We considered the opportunity to speak with him. We considered the message we would send. And President Trump made the decision this was the right approach based on the activity that had taken place in the lead up to the G20 summit.
So is there going to be an opportunity down the road for the president to meet with Putin?
The president's made clear the conditions for that meeting.
What are the conditions?
We want the sailors returned. We want the ships returned.
And once the Russians do that, there'll be a summit?
The president has said he wants to meet. He wants to have a conversation with President Putin. There are lots of things that we need to find paths forward on together, lots of places. Americans are at risk. He's trying to find a way to move forward with Russia. And now this jumped in the middle of a time when they could have begun to have a discussion where we might have made some progress. We regret that, but the Russians caused this meeting to be canceled by their behavior in the Kerch Strait.
When is the president going to meet again with the North Korean leader?
I don't know. I hope it'll happen pretty soon. We're working hard at it. I think it'll happen shortly after the first of the year, but I don't have any additional information to share with you this morning, Wolf.
What's the problem right now?
Progress
with the North Koreans?
Yeah. Well, the progress we've made has been good.
No, what's the problem?
Well, the progress we've made has been good. We're not having missiles launched. There haven't been any nuclear tests. We continue to have conversations about the right next step, that is the right substantive next step, not the process next step of meetings. We're working with partners all across the world, the South Koreans, the Japanese. Remember, Wolf, these are global sanctions put in place by the United Nations Security Council, which denied North Korea the capacity to improve their economy. That's not going to change. Unlike previous administrations that when they got to a point that became difficult, wrote checks for tens and hundreds of millions of dollars and let the North Koreans off the hook in that sense. We're determined to fulfill the commitments that were made by Chairman Kim in Singapore, and we're working hard at it.
A final question on Mexico right now. It looks like U.S.-Mexican relations are improving right now. You're off to Mexico for the inauguration of the new president, and the president, President Trump, signed together with the leaders of Mexico and Canada, the U.S.-Mexico-Canada new trade agreement. But there's still a lot of tension along the border, and there's a lot of uproar about whether or not the U.S. should go ahead and build a new wall, spend all that money. Whatever happened to the president's commitment for so long during the campaign that Mexico would pay for the wall?
The wall's going to get built. I have already developed a good relationship with my counterpart, Marcelo Ebrard, the incoming Foreign Secretary of Mexico. We've met a number of times already. I'm unfortunately not going to make the inauguration as it's taking place today in Mexico, but he'll travel to Washington on, well, I guess will be his second day in office. And we're going to continue to develop this relationship. It's not just focused on the migration issues that draw all the headlines. There are many economic issues between our two countries and other commercial. We have transnational criminal organizations that we work on together. It's a broad set of relationships. We're going to work to help build the Mexican economy in the southern part of their nation and work with the Northern Triangle countries too. Those are important elements of what we're trying to accomplish. And soon to be Foreign Secretary, I guess within hours, Brad and I are working hard at it.
And Mexico paying for the wall?
We're going to get the wall built, Wolf.
But will Mexico pay for it?
Wolf, we're going to get the wall built.
I'll leave it on that note.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Secretary, you've got a busy schedule ahead of you. Thanks so much for spending some time.
Thank you, Wolf.